So today here we're going to learn about CI/CD and with Docker. So we all know a bit of CI/CD. In a very few words, in continuous integration, we merge a developer's code into a settled code repository. And with continuous deployment, we automate the steps to deploy the application into various environment, be it QA, staging, or production. So as there are a lot, many tools are already available, why we should use Docker for our CI/CD? First, as we know that with Docker, we can get a consistent environment through which we can basically build an image for the application and then deploy it wherever we want it. We can build it once and run it n number of times. Docker has a very good integration with tools like Jenkins, GitHub, through which we can automate our CI/CD pipeline and do a complete QA deployment. We can dynamically create test environment with Docker, which is pretty fast. We can create, you can have a VM or a bare metal on which you have deployed Docker, and then we can directly go and deploy the application there. Or we can configure a Docker Swarm cluster in which we can deploy our application. So things can move pretty fast if we use Docker for CI/CD. So I'm assuming that you know a bit of Docker, some of its tools, because we're going to cover a lot of stuff in this webinar, and we'll not be able to get time to kind of go detail into any one of them. But I'll give you a cursory view of tools we are going to use, and we'll then jump into our hands-on session, or basically a demo sessions. So first of all, we are going to use Docker for sure. In Docker, we are specifically going to use Docker machine, using which we can provision a VM instance on the cloud and then have it Docker install in it and then manage it. So on the screen, let me just share the terminal here. So as you can see here, what I have done is I have used a Docker machine tool and instructed Docker machine to kind of go and create a VM instance on DigitalOcean, as I'm using the driver DigitalOcean here. I'm providing my API token and giving a VM name webinar. So once I run this command, what happens in the background, the Docker machines goes to the DigitalOcean and create a VM called webinar. By default, it's created with 512 megabytes of RAM and 20 GB configuration, but you can change depending on your need. Once that happens, it would basically install configure search keys, install Docker on it, copies the keys to our local environment, and then basically we can connect to the Docker daemon running on the remote DigitalOcean from our workstation. As you can see here, if I run the Docker machine ls command, which is currently on the screen, you can see there are multiple Docker instances which I have, which are connected by Docker machine. The star sign says that which one is currently active. That means our Docker host, which is again created on the DigitalOcean environment, is the one to which we are connecting to. So whatever commands, now whatever command I'm going to run here, those commands are going to get executed on the DigitalOcean VM, which we have there. So let's say if I say Docker pull, Docker maybe image pull, Nginx Alpine. So this image would get pulled onto our Docker instance, which is running on the DigitalOcean cloud, not locally. So that means we have a Docker binary which acts as a client, but our Docker endpoint is the webinar or the Docker host VM running on the DigitalOcean cloud. So let's just see how it can help us. Maybe I'll just go to slide back and come back here again. With a tool called Docker Compose, we can basically create a configuration file in which we can mention one or more components of our application and then have a way to connect them together, which would start an application. We'll see an example of that later in the webinar today. With Docker Swarm, we can configure one or more nodes and make them a part of a cluster on which we will deploy our application. Then we can scale the application, scale down the application, and so forth. We're definitely using DigitalOcean to deploy our instances and do all the labs there. With the ID, we can basically connect. So Docker has integration with different IDs like Eclipse, Visual Studio Code, NetBeans, through which the ID would act as our Docker client, by which we can connect to our Docker host running on the cloud or the VM on bare metal, wherever we want to. Today we are going to use Visual Studio Code as our ID. With Jenkins, we are going to do CI/CD pipeline. I'm sure that most of you would be familiar with Jenkins. So let's get started on that. So let's just see how we can first integrate. Okay, maybe before that, let me show you quick stuff here. So we are going to try out a sample application, which is called RSVP application, in which we have a backend, which is based on MongoDB, and we have a frontend through which we'll communicate to the backend. The source code of the application is available at this location. So let me quickly show you how does the application look like if it gets deployed. So it looks like the one which on the screen right now. If I put some values here, these values would go to the our database and would get saved there. This is how it looks like. And let's go back to our presentation there. Okay, so generally, how do we do a development? As a developer, we kind of have our ID on which we code, and then we kind of deploy our application on our using the ID what we have, and that's how the typical workflow looks like. But here, what we're going to do is we're going to introduce Docker in between. So whatever development we do, we'll do through our ID, but that ID would basically deploy the application on Docker host so that we can test locally. And then once we test locally, then we can take it and push the code on the GitHub. So let's just see how does it look like. So what I have here is I have the source code repository, which is currently in the RSVP app folder, and I'm going to use code command to basically start the ID. And what we see on the screen is a Docker compose file, which I was talking about earlier. Here we can basically combine our backend MongoDB and the frontend web using the images which are being shown here. So we'll use Mongo 3.3 image for MongoDB and Khare/RSVP app:webinar image for our front end. So now we're in the ID. So what we can do with the ID, which has integration with Docker, I can basically run the command here. I can say there's a shortcut here, which on the Mac is Command Shift P. If I do, I can get these Docker subcommands, which I can use here. For that, I have to install some plugins here, which I have installed for Docker, Python, and so forth. So let's just see how we can do that. So I'm going to press again Control Shift P and say Docker build image. As you can see, it figured out that I have a Docker file in the source code repository. And it asked me to give me the image name, which I'm giving here. I'm giving a tag here, webinar. And as soon as I say the enter, and as soon as I press the enter, what's happening, the Docker client, which is on my host machine, is communicating to my Docker host, which is on the DigitalOcean, and building an image there. Similarly, I again press Control Shift P. I say Docker compose. I get an option to maybe start the application or destroy it. So I'll currently say start the application. As soon as I say that, my application would get deployed on the DigitalOcean VM. So I just wait for it to get deployed. As you can see, my application is deployed on DigitalOcean VM. So what we'll do now is we are going to get the IP address of our DigitalOcean Docker host, which I created earlier. Open the browser and go to the port 5000 by 5000, because we have mentioned that we want to map port 5000 of the host with the port 5000 of the application. Our Python-based application served by default on port 5000. So that's why we are mapping that port. So we'll go here and then press enter. And we can see that our application is not deployed on the Docker host running on the DigitalOcean cloud. So this can be thought as a typical workflow for a developer. So developer go to the IDE, change some codes, and then deploy it locally on the Docker host, which is being configured through the Docker machine or via other means as well, and do a testing there. Once tests get completed, then basically using the IDE, the developer can commit the source code to the source code repository. Okay, so let's now go. So now, as mentioned, that we are going to use Jenkins. So I already have a Jenkins deployment done on the cloud. So again, for that, I have a VM which I created on the cloud with 2 GB of RAM and called Jenkins. So this is my Jenkins environment where I have installed a few packages to manage Docker and connect with Docker host. So for that, if I go to Jenkins, then I go to manage Jenkins. Here I go to manage plugins. The package which I have installed separately is called yet another Docker plugin. This is the one which I have installed. And there are a few Docker plugins which get automatically installed, like Docker pipeline, Docker common plugins. So these are default plugins which comes with Jenkins these days. So we don't have to install them separately. So we just have to install yet another Docker plugin for our demo which we are seeing here. Now, let's just go back to the slides here. So now, as I mentioned, that we have a Jenkins for doing our QA. So with Jenkins, we have plugins. With plugins, we can extend the functionality of Jenkins. So what we want is, the next step is, we want to run our test cases with Jenkins. So if you recall, Jenkins have an agent or the slave on which we run our test cases. Now here we are again want to use the Docker by which we can generate dynamic Jenkins or the slaves. So for that, what we'll do is we'll communicate our Jenkins, we'll configure Jenkins to communicate with our Docker host and create the Docker or Jenkins agent dynamically depending on the requirement. So to make the connection between the Jenkins and the Docker host, we use that yet another Docker plugin. So once we have installed that plugin, what we have to go again is we have to go to our Jenkins and then go to configure or manage Jenkins, configure system. And if we come at the bottom, we'll see an option here, add a new cloud. So here we need to specify the new Docker cloud. So basically here we have yet another Docker as an option coming here. So we have to specify our Docker endpoint to which we can connect. So as mentioned in the presentation, we can see that our Jenkins is connected to the Docker host, which we have configured earlier. So what we'll do is we are going to get the Docker host IP, which we know here. This is the endpoint for our Docker host. So we just give a name here, let's say Docker host webinar. And then we have to give the endpoint here. So this endpoint means that basically if we use 2376 as a port to communicate with our Docker, which by default means that we are going to have a secure connection. So we need to make sure that our Jenkins can communicate securely to our Docker host, which we have configured. And to do that, what we have to provide is we have to add a new host credential. So we, let's say, click on add here, Jenkins. Then we'll say here, Docker host certificate authentication. We click on that. And then we need to provide the keys and certificate by which the Jenkins can communicate to our Docker host. For doing that, what we'll do is we are going to run a command, Docker env, sorry, Docker machine env, Docker host. So what's happening here is when we configure Docker machine, it basically gets the certificates and copies them to our local machine. So we can copy the certificates from our workstation and put them for Jenkins, which means that if I go to this location for our Docker host, I can find these files. So I can copy the key.pam, cert.pam, and the ca.pam and put them here and then save it by giving an ID. So with that, our Jenkins would be able to communicate with our Docker host. So I'm going to delete it here because I already configured in the first place before for the demo. So as you can see that the same thing what we have done earlier, we have put down our Docker host URL, the credentials, and we can test our connections here. So our Jenkins can communicate to the Docker host which we have configured earlier. So once this communication happens, the next thing we have to do is we have to tell to Jenkins, you have to create a Docker slave based on an image. So Docker would definitely run an image, right, to create a container. So we have to configure the Jenkins so that it goes to the Docker host and runs a very specific image, which we can specify here in the images section here. So as we can see that I have used here Cloud Yoga Docker Jenkins Python slave. So this is the slave image which I have created using the Docker file shown on the screen, in which you can see that I am installing Java because Jenkins need to communicate with the Docker with the client. So Jenkins communicate with the slave over Java, so we need to configure Java there. And I've created an user called Jenkins and the password Jenkins here and exposed port 22 there. Now, if we come back to our setup here, we are mentioning here. So after creating the image, we have pushed the image as Cloud Yoga slash Docker hyphen Jenkins hyphen Python hyphen slave. And then configure it saying that the username password for the user in that image is Jenkins Jenkins. And we would be launching a SSH launcher through which the Jenkins master would communicate to the slave, and we have provided a label. This label plays a very important part when we run our jobs using this configuration. So here we are giving a label Docker Jenkins slave for this setup, which means that if I specify in a job saying that I want to run my job against a slave agent on Docker host, if I use this label, Jenkins will automatically go to Docker host and create an instance there. So we'll check that out. So let's just go back to our main Jenkins and look at the sample job. So here we have a sample job, sample Docker host job. Let's go to configuration. So if you look at here is while creating a job, I have mentioned a label. This label is a very important thing to mention if you want to run our jobs using Docker. So here I have used Docker Jenkins slave. If I remove it, if I just specify Docker here, you can see it automatically comes because we have mentioned that label there. Now in the code, what we are saying is just a very simple echo, hello from Jenkins slave and sleeping for some time. Let's just go and build this now. So if I go back to the Docker machine on my workstation, it would basically give me all the containers. It is connecting to, so I'm currently on my Docker, on my workstation, which is connecting to the Docker host. So if I do Docker container ls, you can see that there would be a container which would be running from our Docker Jenkins Python slave and doing the hello world, right? So basically, look at here, look at the logs here. We can see the logs that it has printed the echo message and sleeping for 20 seconds and a success. So basically what happened here is that a Jenkins master has created an agent on the Docker host, perform the job what is supposed to do, and then the Jenkins the Docker container or the Jenkins agent is been deleted automatically. So if I go again to the Docker command line and do Docker container ls, you would not see that container which got created earlier. So it means that container is getting created, doing the job, and then getting destroyed. While we are here, let's just go and destroy our application as well, which we started earlier using the ID. So again, I say Docker compose down. And this is going to destroy the application on the on our Docker host. As we can see, there would not be any containers running on our Docker host now. So next, go next. Now what we want is, okay, maybe before that, let me show you one more stuff. So I'm hoping that you might have used Docker Jenkins pipeline feature, in which basically we can define different stages for a given pipeline which we are building. So here you can see that I have a stage hello and I have a stage bye, in which I'm just doing a simple echo. And this node instruction means that I want to run the job inside Docker Jenkins slave only. So basically this is the one which you have configured earlier to create the Jenkins slave. So while we are here, I would like to highlight the pipeline syntax. Here, basically, we can choose different syntax. Like here, we can say with Docker, something like that. So basically, we can get different steps which you want to build for the pipeline with the help of this syntax manager. Anyway, so here is our simple pipeline. We are just saving it here. And then if we execute this now, what will happen is a new build get triggered and we'll see this hello and bye, two different stages, which is going on. one after another. So if you look at the logs, you would see that it just waiting to create the new Docker Jenkins slave. It create a new slave on the Docker host, did the echo hello world, and then echo by all, and then success. This is a very simple pipeline which we can create. Okay. So now let's see how we can run our test cases so let's just see. So basically we have this application here. So our application is that a cloud versus RSVP app, but I have forked it under my name Khare. And here we have some test cases. So we want to make sure that these test cases get executed when we deploy our application. But in the current thing, current job, we are just executing those test cases. Let's look at the configure here. Again, we are saying that I want to run inside the Jenkins agent. And then getting the work source code repository here. And then these test cases we want to execute here. So let's just again run the job. It will kind of again go and create a new container on our Docker host, as you can see, which would execute the job, execute the test cases. Okay, while it's going on, meanwhile, is there any question which I can answer right now? As we can see, it's kind of getting the packages, building the. This is one question. Is Jenkins pipeline for multiple projects in the repository good practice? No, so basically you should have. So for a given project, which are components for a given application, they should be part of the same repository. But if you have multiple components, like here we have a backend and the front end, then we should have a different repositories for our code base. Second one was how to use. How to use Docker local registry without login in the pipeline. So basically you need to configure Docker registry such that it does not take any password. I think there is an option called insecure registry, which you have to pass. And the second question was, we can also use Docker host as Jenkins slave also. Maybe if you want to use it, but that's your choice, but not recommended here. What happens if the build fails? Does it roll back? So no, it will not roll back in the current scenario because we haven't configured that, but you can configure that to kind of do a rollback. When we see a staging, we can check it out that staging fails. If staging fails, then we kind of get a fail message in the staging stage, and we have to kind of go to the staging environment and clean it up. So let's go forward now because we have a lot to cover, and we'll come to the questions later point of time. So now next we want is, once our test cases are being passed, we want to push our image to Docker registry. So let's just look at the Docker registry, how we can push them to Docker registry. So again, let's coming back to our test cases. The jobs. Here we go to Docker, RSVP Docker Hub Push. If you look at the configure option here, we have again built the different stages here. So here we are saying test. So this would test the images, test our code. So here I have, to run the test cases, I've created a new file in our source code repository. which basically have the same testing steps here. Let me show you that. So here is the script which I've created. This would execute the test cases what we have. And then in the second node instruction, I'm saying that clone the RSVP. So here, the test I'm doing only on the Docker Jenkins slave. Next, the rest of the steps are going to happen on the master, or we can configure it on different machine as well. So what we are saying here is, again, that with the help of the pipeline syntax, that connect to the Docker host, which is again coming back to this IP address and the credential ID which we have given earlier, and doing a Docker build here, saying that docker.build, build an image with this name, which is, so we'll have a Docker file, as we have seen earlier, in our repository. So take this Docker file and build a image. And then we are giving a credential here to push the image to Docker registry. So for that, what we have to do is, we have to kind of go to the Jenkins, go to credentials, and then create, add a credential for our Docker hub username and the password, which we can select from here. So I've already given it for my name, which you can see here. And I'm going to use this authentication to push the image to Docker hub. Let's just go and look at that. So here we have a with Docker server, and we are pushing our image to the Docker hub with the name of nkare/rsvp-app-webinar. Again, do a build now. Let me show you the logs of the previous build so that we saved some time there. So what's going to happen now is, we are going to run our test cases as we did earlier. Once test cases pass, we are going to build a new image. This is happening here. Once the image is built and get tagged with the right name, we are pushing our image to Khare RSVP app webinar. If you kind of go and push to the Docker hub, and that's how this particular thing would complete. So the next is, what we'll do once our image is called Docker registry, what we'll do is, we'll configure a staging environment. So it is being created using the Docker machine. So I again have another VM, which is created on the Docker distribution cloud called staging. And on this, for the staging, again, we need to kind of provide our credentials, like the one we did for Docker, so that Jenkins can communicate to the staging VM. Let's just check it out if our job is being finished. Still going on. Let's just see the logs if something is fine here. Yeah, so I'm just taking some time here to kind of do it. But meanwhile, let's look at the Jenkins, the RSVP staging job here, in which we'll push our image to the staging server after the test has been passed and image is being built. Go to the configure here. So this is the same thing what we have done. So basically, we have added only the staging part here, other than the test, building an image and pushing the Docker hub. So here, if you look at what we are doing is, we are again communicating to the staging server. Instead of Docker host, we are now communicating with the staging server and deploying the image, deploying the application using Docker Compose. Once the image gets deployed, we are using a section or a section here called input. So once the image get deployed on the staging environment, it would kind of spit out this passage saying that, go and check it out if everything looks okay. So we go to this URL and check out our application if everything is fine. If it's fine, then we'll just go and destroy the application, because in the staging, just check whether it's fine or not. If it's fine, then we are good. So let's just go and check if our Docker Hub one has been finished. Yeah, so I think our Docker Hub push has been over. Let's go to staging one and build this thing now. This was again the same steps, and then we're testing, then building the image, Docker Hub, and then it would deploy the staging server. So it would take some time. So let me take some questions. So question is, instead of creating the image by running the test, why can't we simply pull the image in Docker registry? Yes, we can do that. It is because we want to make sure that the image which we have on Docker registry is the one which we expect. Think about you have put the code right now, and you have added some code in the source code repository. And you want to make sure that you have more testing and so forth. That's why we are doing the testing and then pushing the image to Docker Hub or registry, from which we pull it again. I hope this makes sense. Are there any Docker-specific plugins for Jenkins? Yes, so there are, as I showed you earlier, there are Docker-specific plugins, and we are currently using the yet another Docker plugin, but you can find more plugins. Just go to the plugin sections. Go to the installed ones. So by default, Jenkins now comes with different Docker plugins, like here, Docker Common Plugins, Docker Pipeline. These are the default Docker plugin, which comes with the Jenkins. And we have installed yet another Docker plugin for our jobs. Next question, is it possible to modify Docker image mongo.3 and push it to the same repository which is used in the Docker Compose file? So is it possible to modify Docker image? Yes, as long as you push the image the same name, it is fine. So let's say you're saying that you will take the MongoDB Docker file, modify something, and put it again back Docker Hub or Docker registry. If it is with the same name, then it is fine. But if you change the name like Mongo:3.4, then you have to update the Docker Compose file as well before committing the Docker Compose file or for the operation which we'll do. So let's just see the status of our staging state now. Or staging job right now. So we're running our staging job here. Let's go here again. On the logs, what's happening? Yeah, so as you can see that our output, we have done with the test, we build the image, and we are saying that image is being put to Docker Hub. Now if you look at let it get refresh. So if you look at here, it's waiting for something, right? Let's click on that. It should say, can we proceed further? So I'm not sure why it's not showing on this on the mouse cursor. I just go to the logs here. Go to the console output. And as you can see that everything has happened before this step. It's asking us to check whether the application looks fine or not. So let's just go here. And I'm going to open this link. Come on. Yep. So as you can see that our application is now running on the staging environment. So once this looks fine, then what we'll do is we're just going to say proceed. The proceed would basically go and destroy the application from the staging environment. Just refresh the page here. Sometimes does not load itself. As we can see, once we have did the proceed, it is approved by Neependra. That means that somebody has approved that the application looks fine. And then it will basically go into Docker Compose and destroy the application from there. Okay. The next step is, once we have deployed the application in the staging environment, what we want is, we want to deploy the application in the production. In the production, what we're going to use a Docker orchestration or some kind of a cluster in which we can deploy our application. So here we're going to use Docker Swarm. Basically, with Docker Swarm, we connect multiple nodes together in a cluster, and using which we deploy the application on them. So here, it looks like this. The setup looks like this. So we have a Docker Swarm cluster in which we have a master and a node, and our application, we deploy the application on that particular cluster using the Docker stack. So Docker Compose is generally being used for deploying the application into the single node instance. So when we have configured just a single node for Docker, we use Docker Compose to deploy the application. But if you want to deploy the application into the Docker Swarm, we use Docker Stack. So Docker Stack looks similar to Docker Compose file. Here, just a few changes maybe. So we're not seeing those changes here because we have used just the Docker Compose file and just change the version number here to 3. That's it. But there are more advanced options which are available with the Docker stack, which one should explore later. So let's just go to our end-to-end setup now. Go to the configure again. So again, our things are same with till the staging part. What we do in the production environment, we just say deploy in production. And again, with the same syntax, with the pipeline syntax, we say go to production. And in the production, go to this ID. So what we have done earlier is I have configured two node. So I've configured two nodes. I've taken two nodes on DigitalOcean, manager and the node. And I've created a Docker Swarm on that. And then added the Docker Swarm with my to my Jenkins, like the way we did earlier. So I just go back to here, and here, if you see here, we are deploying the application using Docker Stack, Docker Stack deploy command. The good thing about Docker Stack is, let's say you are already running an application on the production environment, and you just deploy a new version of it. So what Docker Stack would do? It would just look at the changes what we have done and just redeploy those parts and leave the entire stack as it is. So what do I mean by that? So if you look at here, I have this production environment called cyrsup.com. This is currently we are running, and this seems to be fine. So basically what we're going to do now is we are going to change something in our source code, which, and we would ask it to trigger then. So what we'll do now is we are going to go to our source code repository, and we are going to change something in our front end. So front end is coming from this profile.html. So if you look at here, it is coming as, and the placeholder is coming as enter name, and it's coming as enter email for the email field. Same as we can see in the source code. So here I'm going to say enter your name. For the email, I'm going to say enter your email. Then I'm going to save it. I'm going to put a message, updated profile. Yes. And then I'm going to say push to my code. So what would happen is this would actually going to put the changes onto my GitHub repository. To check it out, let's just go there, look at the profile.html in the templates folder. And you can see that we got enter your name and enter your email here. Now let's just go back to the our jobs again. And let's just now run RSVP end-to-end. So it's again going to kind of do all the steps, doing the test cases. Then it is going to build the image, push the image, Docker Hub, and so forth. Let's look at the questions meanwhile. How you version images when you do Docker push from a pipeline? If you keep creating the images, how would the version of those images? So yeah, so by default, we are pushing it with the same tag of the image. But what we can do is while we are building our pipeline, we can pass an environment variable in which we can build, in which we can give the build number or the Git ID or whatever that can be passed while building the, while pushing the image. So that you have to do extra step there, which I haven't shown here, but you can pass the image version or the image version or the tag, whatever, using the environment variable. Next question is, is there any limitation of implementing Docker CI/CD? So as far as I'm not aware of anything, because what you can do in typical CI/CD that can be done with Docker. So I haven't seen anything which can't be done. What will be the downtime? So if you are using Docker stack, so when Docker stack, there are multiple options available in which we can basically have a rolling update. So basically, let's say if we have 5 copies of the front end running, what we can say is while deploying my application, take one front end at a time and redeploy it. So basically, let's say if you have 5 of them and you say that after 10 seconds, take one front end down. So what would happen is 4 of them would be older version, one would be new. And similarly, the after 10 seconds, second one go down, new one would come up with that. So there would be no downtime if you kind of look at that way. If you are using the rolling update, so for that you have to explore Docker stack in detail there. Can we do versioning of the image? As I mentioned earlier, that we can do. We just need to pass the right environment variables, and while pushing the image, we have to kind of tell that, okay, build the image with a new version. Okay, so now if you're looking at the screen, we are at the staging stage here, which is again paused. We can go and look at the application here at this location. And as we can see in our staging environment, we got the right one, enter your name. Instead of enter name, we got enter your name. Now go back to the this thing and say proceed. The proceed would basically destroy the application in the staging environment and take the application into the production environment. Let's look at the output here, console output here. As you can see, it's stopping the on the staging. Now it is going into the production environment and using the Docker stack deploy and updating the new service which we have deployed there. So if I go back to my production environment, which says coming from rsgpapp.com, cyrsgp.com, if I refresh my page, you can see that I got a new version of the application deployed on our production environment. So this is how we can do the production. So what you're seeing here is we are getting the application into directly a URL, but exactly what's happening here is the application, what we have, a Docker stack file, what we have, that would deploy the application onto the 5,000 port of each node. So if you know a bit of Docker Swarm, you would kind of relate to it. So if you look at the Docker stack file, so here we are saying it map port 5000 of the cluster with 5000 of the application, which means that actually I'm going to access my application onto my manager node on port 5000. Okay. But what I have done on top of that setup, I have configured a load balancer using Nginx. and Nginx is being pointing to my cyrsvp.com, which basically, once I hit this URL, it kind of transfers the load to either the master or to the slave node. Okay, and what we have seen here is there are a few other stuff which I would like to mention. Is one is basically, if you look at our another jobs, these jobs are currently hard coded. Like here we have like TCP go to this URL, this particular endpoint. What we can do, we can do parameterize this, and while parameterizing that, we can kind of take away the hard coded part from the pipeline stuff. And second thing, there's a feature called Jenkins file. So what we can do is we can use the Jenkins files and push our pipeline script with the so basically what I meant is we can take this pipeline script, go to our source code repository and create a new file called Jenkins file, and with that Jenkins file we can basically point out our pipeline. Sorry, not this one. Here the complete thing, we can copy it here, and we can make the our pipeline as a part of our source code. That would make things much more easier for us. Anyway, that I'll leave it to explore further. So yeah, that's all what I have, and I think we have just 5 more minutes left. So any last minute questions if you have? Yeah, there are a few questions. What is the language of RSVP? It's Python. You can check out the source code repository there. What about Java? So similarly, the way we have done for Java, for Python, you can do with the Java. So think about what we do in the containers world. We deploy the application and access them via the endpoints, or basically the REST API. So you can deploy the application into any application, any language, and just access, just make the REST APIs available for other application to consume. Is production about the old in production? What about the old containers? So basically, what's happening in the, if you use Docker stack, it would basically take away the older containers and build the new containers for them. So that's what's happening. So it will kind of kill the old containers and build the new containers for you with the Docker stack. Okay, any more questions? Okay, what code structure does pipeline script follow? It is a Groovy script. If you look at this, is a Groovy syntax, is a Groovy language. Okay, 1 more minute for the questions, if you have some. Yeah, there will be downtime in that case. So if you have, so currently we just have one front end, but let's say if we have more than one front end, and there we can kind of say, instead of shutting down all them at once, take one by one. So basically out of 5, one would be destroyed and you would be created on that. So there would not be any downtime if you use rolling updates with Docker stack. So explore Docker stack further to answer that question. What is the better way for test? Is Docker build and run plus test? So it is your choice. The question is, what is the better way for test? Is it Docker build and run plus test? So it's your choice again. So basically it's depending on your requirement, how do you want to do it? But I have shown you different options here, which you can kind of take it and do it. Yes, again, the same question, or test it without Docker build, your choice. Docker Compose or stack. Docker Compose, as I mentioned, is generally being used when you deploy the application to single node. But if you deploy in a cluster where you have more than one nodes, they use Docker stack. Implementing CI/CD for microservices effective? Yes, definitely, because in microservices, you would have multiple components. And if you can test them easily with CI/CD, it will be really helpful for your team. Because let's say if your complete application consists of hundreds of microservices, and if you don't test them individually, if you don't test them like in a complete bundle, then it'd be a loss for the team. So you should definitely use CI/CD and do the testing and so forth. Thanks, everyone.